want to pass these around. These are copies of the ordinance that Councilor Adams and Inspector are considering presenting for the styrofoam. So there's two pages, I think. I'm sorry, I ran out of staples.
Can we see the final lights?
Want me to do it? They might shoot me, though. You're a counselor.
He didn't, the cop didn't know that. He's going, what are you doing? Trying to go to a meeting. He said, are you supposed to be here?
Don't you know who I am?
Oh, the bottom ones are staples.
Is that Bill?
Wait, I mean, this is a song right now.
Is that Glinty on?
Carrie's always on.
Oh, maybe it's his phone.
Be lying.
No, I'm not lying.
Because I feel like I'm always like out of like.
Yeah.
I mean, no.
It's just like, oh no, we're causing so much trouble.
I mean, we're breaking the sidewalks.
I mean, to the skate park, from the skate park.
Everyone did really bad at the issues.
Oh, I know.
I like stopping yours.
No, but except for Nick.
58?
Yeah.
That's why I feel bad for me. Like, she always wants to go over me.
After having pneumonia, for weeks, I got to have a mental health, and not make it at all.
And Mila, like, she got really close to states, like, didn't.
Wait, what? What'd you guys say?
She had, like, it was like a one, double, like, really low. Like, barely. I felt it. Because I think it was the best time to, like, not.
There's a typo here.
Yeah.
There's a typo on the first page.
Especially if I say.
It's like the second or third.
And this was written by city councilor?
Was has been added.
Was has been.
Maybe that's like some weird official thing they have to do, like.
Was has.
We can't just say has been added.
It happened in the past.
It's legal speak.
We'll see if I'm any good anymore, but.
It's just to confuse you.
I'd say like once added.
I've been like in practice, and I'm just like, I can't even do butterfly. You could be like a spray freestyler.
No, like, I'd be doing a spray freestyle.
Because you.
Because I didn't go to water.
Yeah, that's what I.
All I can do.
That's what I think.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Councilor Jesse Adams, Councilor at Large.
Councilor.
And Vice President of the City Council. And I print up copies.
Thank you.
No, good catch. Good catch. Well, that's actually, that's called a scrivener's error. We gotta catch those before we send them on, otherwise we'll miss them. So, good catch. Well, you have a copy. We're all set. The PD came by.
Yes, so, the inspector's.
He's the one coach.
Someone took the alarms and so on.
Oh, Sarah, yeah, Sarah was going through it. She called it in, but they came by to just check. And of course, we need to stand at the door. But I think we're cool.
All right.
So I got a wood block on the door, so. Well, you know what? I didn't know that you guys were doing a slideshow. If I'd known that, we could have rigged this up to project it. And we looked really high-tech and we were really.
Until we're landing up here, we probably aren't doing.
Should we retract? I printed one of these out, but I'm glad.
You printed up, so I printed up 25 copies, so we should be covered.
Okay, cool.
Should I hand up minutes?
Yeah.
Just wait till there's someone's car, just like. Lots of cars. Sam, do you have any idea how many people's houses?
It wasn't even me.
I'm just assuming this is around.
She's trying to go by me.
Mariah's supposed to be here. She is.
I And she bringing the laptop to the lockdown.
Yeah. Dude, you gotta go to the lockdown there.
So we'll watch on the laptop.
Yes.
What side?
Yeah, how do you know how to turn it on?
Well, he's, but he's across the way at the CPA meeting. Well, we need a VGA connection cord here.
Let's break into open. Mary broke this thing off.
Dude, I'm like, I need to.
Oh, Brent.
So.
Was it to talk about it?
Someone just contacted me, I interviewed him, and he was.
Why didn't you answer? I was in your city.
Well, I was. So. Someone was bad, and I thought, some she called up. She made sure it was.
Our street.
Oh, I mean, like.
I don't think it's that.
That's right. Give it as good as we get.
And I mean, I put the format.
Yeah, but this will be hitting on high, and like, of course. Got the bash for all of them.
I'm looking right there.
Yeah, it could be interesting.
You guys got the moment?
Oh, wait. Hey, do I park in there?
I did.
Which?
Oh, yeah.
There's a seat here, there's also extra copies of the ordinance there. Is. Do you know if Jonathan's coming?
He's not, he's at baseball tryout.
Nice. He's inside. Council Jesse Adams is here. He's the proponent of the ordinance that you guys are all looking at. He's the one of the principal sponsors. We don't know if Council Spector's gonna be showing up. Probably not. He's in the Bahamas or something.
Oh, lucky.
Yeah, he has a.
Yeah, he's that baby.
He has a tough life. He's a tough life. Keeps going back with a suntan, sitting there. It's really hot. Anyway, so, and you guys, Jesse's interested in hearing what you guys discovered. And just to break it down, Counselor, these guys broke up into groups to focus on specific areas that have, for the purposes of discussion. Some of the ones that you guys were talking about, environmental, health, economic impact, and there was one other one, right? What was that? Right.
What was it?
And I don't know how you want to do this first. Maybe if Jesse described what he's talking about, what they're thinking about doing for the scope, and then you guys can talk about your supporting material.
Yeah, that sounds like a good plan. So this isn't set up for a meeting.
I didn't know you wanted that. If I could barely get in the building, but if I had known that, we could have gotten the VGA cable and turned that on. I didn't know that this needs to be plugged in here with a VGA cable off a laptop.
Okay. Well, I think the creators of the PowerPoint have some feedback.
I did bring my laptop. I have the.
So we can see on the laptop.
Yeah, the thing is, it's on Google, so at least it connects to the internet.
You should be able to connect to the internet through Northampton Wi-Fi. There should be free Wi-Fi. And I can call that up too, so we can have at least two screens. So.
So while that's happening, Councilor Adams.
That's it.
Thank you. Do you want to just brief us on where you're
at already. Yeah, sure. Thank
you. Oh, right. But beforehand, is it okay? Well, just approve the minutes. So I can't do it. Somebody else.
Second.
All in favor? All opposed? Any opinions? Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
I noticed that other communities have banned the use of polystyrene styrofoam, and I think that Northampton is a community that values being environmentally conscious, and I also think that Northampton is a community that values social responsibility. Mm-hmm. I took it upon myself to look at some other communities and what they've done with this issue, and then I went and using the Amherst town bylaw as a guide, I went and drafted this. Paul Spector, the Ward 2 city councilor, is interested in this issue as well. And so he and I are the initial sponsors of the ordinance, but I've had offers of other councilors joining in as sponsors. Right around or shortly after the time I drafted the ordinance, I learned from Councilor Dwight that this committee was interested in the same issue, and I was happy to hear that. So I have spoken with Susan Waite. Do you guys know who Susan Waite is? She's the
Amherst. Yeah, I spoke with her, and Jonathan and I met with her a couple of weeks ago.
Great, and she's also the coordinator for Northampton as well.
Okay.
So she told me a bit about the Amherst process and what they went through. And they had actually remarkably little opposition. And part of the reason they had such little opposition is because they had really good outreach. So I haven't presented this to any other councilors besides Councilor Dwight and Councilor Spector. This committee is the first committee to have seen it. There's no other committee, council committee that's seen it. And the reason why is because I wanted to try to figure out what sort of public outreach should be done, if any, before it's introduced, or if that should come after it's introduced. As I said earlier, Amherst was pretty successful with limited opposition because of their outreach efforts. And so while this isn't a secret document or anything, I haven't presented it to the council yet because I'm trying to figure out what sort of processes I should go through, or anyone else who wants to join me in introducing it to the business community and the other segments of the community that would be affected by it. So here's the ordinance. I can run through it briefly if you want.
Yeah.
Should I do that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, basically, you know, the beginning is where in our code book, and just so you guys know, I'm a lawyer in my day job, so I'm kind of familiar with some of this stuff. The beginning section, right under ordinance, is where this would go in our book of laws or code book. Underneath that is the purpose. I took a good amount of this from the Amherst bylaws, as I said earlier, including the findings. I tailored it somewhat to Northampton, but I deferred to some of their findings. For example, some of their findings, paragraphs 2, 3, and 4. Also, if you'll notice the communities that banned it in paragraph 4 in the findings, there are no cities, to my knowledge, in this state that have banned it. So if we did, we would be the first, unless someone else beats us to it. And I think that'll be a good thing for Northampton.
Right.
A good number of Northampton establishments have already stopped using polystyrene food containers. Amherst, in their bylaws, said that 60% had already stopped using it. When I spoke to Susan Waite, she said that number was very conservative. It might be up around 70 or 80%. And I think that probably a good percentage of Northampton establishments have already stopped using it, particularly downtown. Definitions, those are, some of them are quite technical, and I took most of these definitions from the Amherst bylaw. That's not my strong point. I defer to them heavily, and a lot of these terms are things that I familiarize myself for the purposes of the ordinance with, but I don't really know much about otherwise. If you'll notice, under city facility, it includes any building, structure, land, or park owner operated by the city of Northampton. And city facility users also includes, last sentence, concession contracts with the city, city managed concessions, city sponsored events and food services provided at the city's expense. So it's pretty sweeping. And what else? Oh, deferments, that's important. We want to create no hardship for any businesses. So we're giving them opportunities to use the supplies they have while figuring out how to come into compliance with this ordinance if it passes and if it takes effect. And they can be granted deferments if they're having a hard time complying, because while we want them to stop using styrofoam, we don't want them to, some businesses are operating on razor thin profit margins and we really don't want to create a hardship, but we would like them to phase it out as many other businesses have done. And section 7 is enforcement, and there are fines for enforcement. There's actually a thing, I think it got cut off here.
Well, yeah.
After
there's a fourth page?
Capital, yeah, there's a fourth page, which I guess you guys can get a later point. But talks about the actual penalties. First violation, $100, which will come after a warning notice. So they're getting a warning, they'll get a warning notice before they get fined. Second one's $250. And also I've learned that, I hope this doesn't happen. A violation of any ordinance can actually be brought as a criminal complaint in the district court, and that's not my hope, but the hope would be that they'll be paying fines, or hopefully they'll come to compliance, but there is the possibility that they'll be paying fines if they don't comply. So I'll open it up to questions, but I think I've given the reasons why I think this is important for Northampton. I'd be happy to hear what this commission has found in its research, and I'd be happy to learn what, if any, interest this commission has in joining the effort to get this ordinance passed. Thank you.
Do you want to talk about the PowerPoint?
Well, the problem is I can't connect to internet.
You can? You found Northampton Wi-Fi?
On the Northampton public Wi-Fi, and it's just not.
Did it ask you for permission? It usually asks you for your email. If you go to try to open up any page in your browser, it should pop up.
Yeah, it just says fail to open page. I tried it both on Safari.
Well, we could open it on that because it's a Google Doc. So.
We can go on my iPhone.
Yeah, that'll be fine.
Yeah.
Here, let me see my mind. Let's see.
The password is students.
So what we've done is we've split up into different groups, and each group has been responsible for researching about, what are the groups?
Environmental impact, health impact, economic impact, and replacement solutions.
I'm sorry, can you say this again? Environmental impact?
Health impact, economic impact, and the replacement solutions.
Thank you, Coach.
Actually, you don't need to do that. You just simply agree to the ridiculous terms that no one ever holds you to. So, yeah, don't start downloading music and stuff. By the way, this is DSL speed. This is not a very fast Wi-Fi. So you on?
Nope.
Did you click agree? And
I clicked continue.
When you get there, can you send me an invite to the Google Doc?
I think I did.
I bet you did. Let me see, but I got it on my laptop.
So, we didn't get information from all of the separated groups.
I think we did.
We ended up getting off for
you. Yeah, we did.
Oh, great. Perfect. Mm-hmm. And I was there, so how did that end up looking?
Oh, it looks like a PowerPoint.
Mm-hmm.
It's like information, and it's pretty straightforward. So
our idea was that we would create this PowerPoint to show for outreach.
Well, yeah, pretty much just to like justify why this is
legitimate.
Yeah.
So when you say outreach, who are you referencing?
Business community, any interested environmental groups, the city, schools, and
Who are the others? We were thinking about the women's, the Northampton League of Women's.
And actually, if you can invite Counselor Adams on that and Jim here.
Sure.
Want to cough up your emails, gentlemen, so that, oh, you know, you got, you can go on Wi-Fi on your super MacBook Air. You can look at it on there.
I go on my iPhone.
Well, yeah, I thought we'd share with other people though, Jim.
What, I am sharing, you can use it.
No, but use your, can we use the screen on your computer?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, what's your email?
I was texting Robin.
Jesse, which would you prefer? How can you access Google? Is it through your Gmail account?
Gmail's better, yeah. J-E-S-S-E dot M-I-C-H A-E-L A-D-A-M-S at gmail.com. Jesse dot my letters, one dot.
CareerWorks CC at Comcast.net.
This technology rocks.
Yeah, what did they do before?
We passed out paper.
Paint pictures.
Paper. Pictures. We drew pictures on the board.
Pictures on the cave wall.
Yes. Or we yelled really loud.
Memorize
it all, and then recited a chapter for us, and put people in comas and drag them home.
So what am I doing now?
So you're getting an invite. You should get an email from Marlena. They'll invite you to the Google Doc. Okay. You click on it, bada boom, bada bing. Password book. Yeah.
What is
Google?
Oh, what's
Google?
Oh, yeah.
And then you'll be part of the inner sanctum, the sanctum sanctorum. Yeah, so these guys actually, they've been working on it for a while, fits and starts, and guys were cramming, weren't you, the other day? But got all the groups together and researched and did a lot of information search on just for their discussion in the absence of a proposal. So they, and they put together this, actually, really good PowerPoint.
Can you like
slides
it?
Yeah. You spared us the pictures. I think, you know, that's good. There are some pictures?
There's one picture.
Yeah, this is, I mean, usually people load it up with pictures, like clip art. It's really excruciating.
Can you access
like a guy like...
Can you get online?
Yeah, I'm trying to
Here, you can try my phone.
Well, if you guys want to show on your laptop, and I'll show on my massive screen here on my iPad, and we'll just sort of...
So do we have three laptops going up? Are there three large screens?
Well, there are three screens. Two of them can't get connected.
People can sit behind me like it's a movie.
Did you get on?
I got it right here.
All right, okay, cool. Well, if you can point your screen so other people can see it.
Look, I'm showing it to Councilor Adams.
Oh, okay. Who's doing the presentation? Who gets to lead the presentation?
That was kind of unclear.
Is unclear?
Your chief of staff.
Yeah.
Who could have filed the PowerPoint?
We did on the
camera. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, why don't you guys make the presentation then? Since you guys have it on the screen.
I want to watch
it on the screen. I mean, you guys don't get to see. Yeah, exactly. I'm going to be stuck with who's looking next.
Okay, so one of the subcommittees that we made
we're
was
on the health slide right now.
Yes.
We're on the health slide.
Okay, health.
So second page. Research the health impacts of styrofoam and
with food and stuff. So styrene is the main ingredient in styrofoam, and it is possible carcinogen linked to leukemia, lymphatic cancer, tumors, and genetic DNA duct damage.
When we say possible, it's in the like 99% chance category, so it's not, it hasn't been like completely proven, but the chances are exceedingly high that it does, it is carcinogen.
Yeah, and it can be transmitted through air, water, soil, obviously contact with styrofoam, and like business emissions. Click.
Thank you.
No, there were two health slides. There were two blocks. I went to the right spot.
Yeah, just go to the second health.
Okay.
You corrected my knowledge.
Okay, so styrene, especially if you're working with it, is really bad because you have repeated extended exposure, and that can lead to negatively affected vision, hearing loss, reaction time, so a lot of like sensory things. And then styrofoam can, So styrofoam not only is bad for you like coming in contact with it just like in your daily life, but it's especially bad for you if you're working with it. And so cutting out production, like lowering the production of styrofoam because there's less demand for it would reduce our contact with it and also reduce the number of people who would have to work with it.
Check. Picture of styrofoam.
Yeah, that's pretty straightforward.
That is styrofoam? On the beach?
Yeah.
So we're now on environmental second thought.
Okay, so styrofoam is non-biodegradable, and you'll get different numbers on how long it takes to decompose. Basically, it's a really, really insanely long time. The National Bureau of Standards for Center on Fire research said that there were 57 chemical byproducts in the creation of styrofoam. So not only is it bad for the people who are working with the styrofoam and making it immediately, it's also bad for the environment when it's being produced.
We're now on the manufacturing.
So hydrofluorocarbons are, for people who have taken environmental science here, that's one of the pollutants that we've learned about, and manufacturing styrofoam produces them. They're called HFCs. They are a greenhouse gas and they contribute to climate change, which,
which is bad.
Yeah. And polystyrene is one of the main components in styrofoam. And petroleum, as most people know, is a non-renewable resource. So again, the problem with production. These are some quotes from a Harvard study in 2008. Yes, made them.
Can you get more specifics on what study this is?
There's a source page in the last.
There is, yeah. And the reason why I ask is because my findings are somewhat limited, and using maybe some of these would be would make it much better.
As you know, obviously, Amherst also did a styrofoam ban, but we also found a study in San Jose, California, and there was found to be little to no decrease in profit from switching to an alternative, and the profit margin would be between 3 and 6%. Based on this same study, most full-service restaurants spend between 1 to 3% on packaging for prepared foods. There would be, again, a small impact from the switch. And New York City, I don't know which part of it, was also considering a styrofoam ban and found it was not cost effective nor possible to effectively sort, recycle, and reuse polystyrene products.
Can I ask a question, please? Mm-hmm. When you state that it's estimated the profit margin will be between 3 and 6%, what does that mean in relation to the idea that there is no negative economic impact?
I don't think that there's no negative economic impact, but the impact that there is very small, between 3 and 6%.
3% per year?
Yeah, it was an annual.
And I think we have to think about, since most businesses function on a 10% profit margin, it's 3% of that 10%, I think is what you're describing, as opposed to 3% over their total profit margin, because that would be substantial. If they only make 10% and you cut out 3%, yeah, that's a third of what they, their profit. Yeah, yeah. So I think those numbers have to be, you have to be pretty precise with those numbers. And
don't
die.
So we're gonna go.
Actually, can I ask one more question?
Yeah.
In San Jose, that bullet there, when it says that most restaurants spend between 1% and 3% on packaging for prepared foods, does that mean that they spend 1% to 3%, and this would not impact that 1% to 3%?
No, it means that of the money that they're spending to, support restaurants, 1% to 3% of that amount spent is on packaging.
So are you saying that if you're spending 100%, let's say, 1% to 3% of that expenditure would be on packaging?
Yeah.
So in relating back to this first one, that 3% to 6%, be referring to 3% to 6% of the 1% to 3% of the cost. That may be, so that you're actually talking about a percent of a percent rather than,
right,
3% of the profit. You're actually talking
a couple of things that are pretty important in this part of the discussion we should get right and be able to present is does this price difference reflect the added cost of alternatives like compostable computer? Are you looking for the CPA?
Yeah,
yeah. Oh, the bid.
Tomorrow night. Tomorrow night.
Yeah, the council chambers. I'll be sitting in a different chair.
At
7 o'clock. 7:05 is when the hearing's scheduled. So, you understand what I'm saying? That doesn't include that. I mean, because principally, what businesses are going to say is, how does this affect me, my bottom line, right out of the gate? So, if we're saying ultimately this will reflect between 1.6 and 3% of your entire profit margin, that's a little more palatable than saying, as I said before. And then also, and that's the cost, that includes the cost of compostables or alternative forms of to-go storage stuff. So, because the biggest thing, that's the political critical thing. I think you'll get a lot of buy-in from the community, but the pushback you're gonna get is from the business community and the restaurants are saying, look, I'm just here above the waterline, and anything that you do that adversely impacts my profit margin, if they make that, and if we can make a case and say that this is going to have a minimal effect on it, we have to have provable numbers that reflect that, so it's broken down in a way that makes sense. So we have replacement options, right?
Yeah.
So the big replacement option is biodegradable cups, because they function just as well, and they're a lot better for the environment, and the process of making them is a lot better for the environment. There's a little trouble in getting them to not like burn people's fingers. So they have to make like extra.
Yeah, the sweater grips for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Grips. Another two other specific alternatives is this green sillet, which is like styrofoam, but takes a lot less energy and is not biodegradable, but close, and is just made from mushrooms. The problem with that would be if you were allergic to mushrooms.
Yeah, that's something that we were interested in, is how, like the potato spoons that they use at Coberry. I don't know if people are allergic to potato spoons. I'm wondering how that
I haven't heard of, I mean, you know, peanut allergies and nut allergies and things like that. I don't know. I think you'll have to do a disclaimer, but for the same, by the same token, there's clearly people who would have a chemical sensitivity to styrofoam. And you have to take that into consideration too. I think the other thing is, how soluble are they? Does the mushroom thing melt when you pour a cup of hot coffee in it? That would be a drag. And, you know, or somebody hands them a cup made out of compost or something, and it turns into funk when you pour your coffee in it. But, and that's the thing is, I mean, principally, what these guys are gonna want, they want something that works and that's cost effective. I mean, I don't think they're married to styrofoam one way or the other.
Well, what makes sense is, like, if we were, when we are making our legitimate proposal, we bring in the options and we test them in front of people.
And the great thing is too that, you know, Amherst is right down the road and they've already done it, and all the businesses are complying with it, including businesses like Dunkin' Donuts and Carmel Farms. And, you know, they've all made that transition, so they all, the options are out there.
It says it breaks down faster. How much faster? Because styrofoam cups break down in 1 million years.
Yeah.
So
I race you can look that up somewhere. It's significantly faster. It's not like 500,000 years. I can get there's a whole web page of everything I can get. But
we also have the link.
All right. Yeah. Here. Perfect.
No. They're a secret password.
And
did it too fast.
Yeah, and then the last option is this Primeware cups and lids, which are not only compostable, but like have been tested with hot liquids and seem to hold up very well and like can deal with moisture and grease and are made from a like sugary starchy material. So breaks down just as easily as compost.
Again, what are any of these? Do they make like clamshells? Because I know a lot of these are about cups, but some places use styrofoam like clamshells for takeout food.
I don't know if they. I don't think we know whether they specifically make like what, like they make cups and they make clamshells, this and that. But like, this is a material that can work, and so probably could be formed into.
I think our point here is just to show is that like styrofoam is not the only option here. So that would be something that's like worth looking into because it is a really valid point.
But yeah, and for testing actually, it's the coffee cup that's used as a standard because it's the one that has to endure the most. The highest variable of heat and cold, and holding liquid. The other ones are holding dry food or wet food. And if they don't get soggy, I mean, that's principally if you're doing to-go container, want to keep the heat, you want to keep the food from spilling, and you don't want it to fall apart when people use it. So, if these all meet that, but then of course, I don't know if you get to it, then there's cost effectiveness as the placements.
Yeah, we have a table on that which we didn't put in, and honestly, it is styrofoam is cheaper. There's no like way around that, but that's kind of a cost shift away.
So somewhere in PowerPoint, is there a section as to how much this costs versus styrofoam?
There's not. We have the chart. We can put it in.
Yeah, let's do that. I'm gonna click. Okay, so this is a proposal.
And this is just that we want to ban styrofoam because of the hopefully minimal economic impacts and the positive environmental and health impacts from removing.
Yeah. Cool.
And we'll see what. One of the things I think you should expand on when going forward on this on the research is the fact that, it, as you point out, it's non-biodegradable and the impact it has on landfills. And because that's a popular conversation, that it, because it doesn't break down, it doesn't biodegrade, that it actually it doesn't get composted in landfills, and actually, since we're coming up with a shortage of landfill space, that's kind of a critical too. So, and clearly, the leachate that it generates is pretty nasty stuff. So,
yeah. So I think, as of right now, I think this is kind of a good skeleton for where we are. But as Nick said something about the clamshells, I remember going to like Haymarket, and they have the ones that are made of like the brown materials. Right. And so if we, I don't know, even if we just go to Haymarket and say, hey, what brand do you use? I think that would be good. Just to show, like, and that's here in our hometown. It's not like there's this like obscure company that exists to make these things made out of mushrooms, but like, you know. So I think that that's something that we should look into.
Yeah, you can talk to their management and ask them cost effectiveness issues. And I mean, I think that's very good to have an example in town to show. And as Jesse pointed out, clearly many of them are already doing that and try and find an inventory of the various restaurants and find out how badly or minimally did this affect their bottom line. Okay. Because that helps when you make the case to other restaurants who are competing with them and say, you know, the ones who are. And honestly, so far, where I'm seeing styrofoam on to-go stuff tends to be the pizza places, the high volume. Yeah, exactly. And so because probably, likely, the sales rep came and say, here, this is what we can give you. It's easy to store, blah, blah, blah. But if they have, you know, with a ban or a potential ban, it'd be good to offer them alternatives before they get upset.
Do you said that you guys you have information on the difference in cost. Do you remember off the top of your head how much?
We can
easily pull it out.
Yeah, I think it was like a couple cents different, but
per item?
Yeah.
We can find it.
Yeah, I would like to know how much, you know, if I go and buy a meal somewhere and the difference in cost that it might, you know, how much would, what would the difference in cost be? If it's only like 3 cents between buying the you know, the styrofoam and then the new cardboard or mushroom container, you know, I'd be willing, I think most people would be willing to absorb that cost.
And in some places actually do charge you a little more for to-go, just to offset.
Really? Yeah. I didn't know that.
I mean, they stopped doing because the customers would get cranky, but if you charge, you know, say we charge a nickel for every to-go order, I don't think a lot of people get upset about that.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Wait, go back.
Okay. So. Okay, so the chart that we have here, which
yes, I think that's there,
which we can share is.
What do you share with them on Google Docs?
Yeah, I'll just explain it briefly though. A cold cup, 8 ounce cold cup is 2 cents EPS, and I think that that's polystyrene, styrofoam. Plastic, it's 5 cents. And then there's a second column which says most efficient alternative material, and then it says for that category, plastic.
And the cost differentiation is 3 cents. It like has all that.
Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah, I'm gonna share this.
Yeah, I'm trying to think the only place that I haven't gotten a cup of coffee from any place around here that's ever done in styrofoam. I only get coffee and styrofoam and Dunkin' Donuts. Yeah, Dee Dee does it. Yeah.
Only the mediums and bigger. If you get a small coffee at Dunkin' Donuts, it's medium stars.
But you get them at church functions and things like that, right? When we go to meetings or people do these things, they get the coffee urn, they have stacks of styrofoam.
Grocery stores.
Grocery store sample cups.
They sell all of this stuff, so when you go and, you know, when you're having a big party and stuff, cookouts and things.
They give you a styrofoam.
That's where you get your styrofoams. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And because they can be cold and hot, that's the nice thing about the styrofoam.
Well, the upside of this is with when you propose an ordinance, there's a discussion and debate in the community and consequently an education. So as you guys, the more education material that you get, So even if styrofoam is still available in certain venues that aren't covered in this ban, it does actually create a heightened awareness by the public to say, well, I prefer not to. Give me a red Solo cup. I don't want a styrofoam cup. Okay. And, you know, no one makes duck faces on Facebook or, you know, Instagram with a styrofoam cup. They're all fucked up with a red Solo cup.
There is a title about the Solo cup.
Yeah.
Did you get what we just shared with you? It's called Economic Effects. There's a chart in the middle.
It's on the second page, and it's from the San Jose website. And there we go.
So we need to obviously add to this, but maybe we should start planning who we're sharing it with and outreach.
Well, I think Council is boy, we'll have to figure out if Paul knows how to drive Google, but we'll see. We'll train him. But I think the two sponsoring counselors, you guys can discuss whether you want to sign on and be one of a sponsoring agency. I'm not sure if that's what you want to consider, if you just want to be the information base. But I also think that the beauty of it is, unfortunately, as this thing moves, you guys are going to go on summer break and the seniors are going to disappear. So, but the idea is that we can transition even into the next term with promotion and the discussion. You guys can participate in the debate. You can actually generate posters, you can generate videos, social media stuff that would promote this whole thing, including duck faces with red Solo cups instead of, or with, just say, how stupid does this look with a styrofoam cup? Actually, it looks stupid regardless, but it's one looks stupider. Because you're about to discover, just as you did with the stormwater discussion, we're about to have the last vote on that tomorrow night, by the way. And that was a 2-year process. So the same thing here, this isn't going to be a 2-year process. This is not as epic as that. But Counselor, do you have any confidence that this will be done by the time these guys go on summer break?
No.
Yeah, and I don't think so either. So, but you guys are laying the groundwork, and this stuff's going to be really helpful, and particularly as we go forward and when we deliberate as well.
I mean, it's possible, but you know, as of this moment, I don't really have anyone to do the necessary outreach to get to the point where I want to introduce it to the council.
Right. They're out of school in 2 months, and so yeah, I don't see. Yeah, doesn't that sound nice? They're out of school in less than 2 months.
That's what I'm saying. We should begin thinking about talking to the Women League of Voters and all those, that when we're a little bit out of the picture, they'll be in the picture.
Yeah, exactly. And Councilor Adams and Councilor Spector and then the other councilors will have the information that you guys are, and having you, if you want to be sponsors, I think also gives us its own weight as well. I mean again, because it's like the stormwater discussion, is that, you know, this isn't an issue that's only left to people who are over 25, because it's not like it stops impacting people at that point. In fact, theoretically, whatever toxic elements have been involved with styrofoam, you're going to be exposed to longer than we are. And so it makes sense that you guys should be contributing members to the debate and the discussion. So,
as of right now, I think outreach is a good place for us to be. I think that's something we can do in terms of like media. I think maybe a video is a good idea, because that could even go on like, I don't know, NCTV or something, and if not, just like share it on Facebook or whatever. What would our like position in this really be?
You can be sponsors. Councilor Adams has invited you to consider being sponsors, which would mean it would say. Have you had every counselor try to sign on this? Because my preference is not.
No.
I would like to keep it to you too.
One other counselor is very insistent, and it might make sense for strategic purposes, but no, I'm going to limit it to just maybe one more counselor.
Okay. And are you okay with having an endorsement or sponsorship from the Youth Commission?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
If you're interested in that,
so,
really appreciate that.
Would us sponsoring it, like, how would that change our role in?
In no way specific, other than the fact that if the law passes, that you guys will be considered the co-sponsors of it. Sponsoring means that you're developing the law and then presenting it, and then the council votes on it. But the sponsorship, Human Rights Commission sponsors ordinances at times, other commissions and committees sponsor ordinances that are relevant to their discussion points, and councilors do.
Also, this is a major piece of legislation. I couldn't think of an example where the Youth Commission sponsored a major piece of legislation.
Right, they never sponsored anything before. Yeah, this would be a first for this commission.
So is this taking us out of power or putting us into it?
You are in power. You are actually, not so much power, you are actually assuming more responsibility. You're assuming responsibility because as sponsors, you have to be able to defend the law that you're proposing. An ordinance is a law. Mm-hmm. And you guys, if you sign on, will be sponsors of this law. So you'll have to own it.
Yeah, but we were going to have to be able to fund it well anyway, so.
That's what I'm saying. But, yeah.
But I think there's enough of us who will be returning next year who know a lot about it that we'll be able to continue with it.
Yeah. So should we vote now?
Yeah, you can vote now if you want, and if giving your own discussion to have a debate, someone would have to make a motion to agree to be sponsors on the proposed ordinance that you see before you. It will change. This will change over time, probably depending on how it could get amended and stuff like that, but the fact is that you guys are the sponsors of this language.
Does somebody want a motion to
referrals? Yeah,
because someone
referred to them, so that was their first entree.
So these sponsored the startup event.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye. Any
abstentions? Okay.
I'm going to draft right to the ordinance right now. That's upon the recommendation of Councilor Jesse Adams, Councilor Paul Spector, and the Youth Commission.
Yay. Okay.
And let me emphasize how significant this is. As Councilor Adams said, this is the first time this committee has sponsored any ordinance. And this is the first time any city in the state of Massachusetts is considering a ban.
Except
we're a city.
Amherst.
And you guys said Amherst is a town. They don't have a mayor. Amherst is the town of Amherst.
Wait,
we're the city of
Northampton.
Hmm?
If they don't have a mayor, who?
They have what's called a city manager or business manager. It's someone who's actually hired to be the mayor. But we have a different form of government. They have town government. They basically have select people, and they have town committee members, and the whole town can pour into a meeting and start yelling about stuff. We have representative government because we're too large to manage something like that. So we have, and so I'm a representative. Councilor Adams is a representative we're representative of the whole city, and the other councilors are representative of wards. And so it's significant. It's first city. Other cities will start to refer to Northampton as, should this pass, it will refer to the Northampton ordinance. Just as we're referring to the Amherst ordinance. But when we're starting to talk cities now, people say, well, has the city ever done this? They'll say, city of Northampton. Although usually people in Boston go, well, of course Northampton.
Yeah.
but that doesn't matter. This is significant when you guys are discussing and considering any amount of work that you've already dedicated to this. So it's just to let you know. I mean, that and the stormwater. Stormwater also, that was a first too. I mean, you know, nothing like that of that size has been referred to the Youth Commission. So the first ordinance that you guys deliberated and made recommendation on.
Okay, we have a little more than 5 minutes. So can we talk about some outreach options?
Well, you want to think about what you do. Do you want to flesh out what you've done here, and particularly with outreach? And I think you guys have a lot of information and reference points and reference stuff for the health impacts and the reason to do it. I think to start working on do a survey of restaurants that you like and stuff, and find out how they dealt with this and what they think about it. I think that, and just come
and
up with
a video compilation.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, and if you do your video, you got to think about that. The video's got to can't be longer than 2 minutes, because right. No one's attention span on any social media is longer than 2 minutes, unless it's really insane or there's nudity, and I don't recommend that. So I think that what you guys should, if you can figure out how to do something that's kind of fun, that's accessible, that's understandable, and remember, you're also talking to kids in the middle school and stuff as well, and you're talking to restaurant owners, you have a big audience that you're trying to appeal to.
So. Yeah, we should narrow down that audience that we're trying to reach. So that would help. The business community and restaurants.
Well, you can make several videos, that's true. I think that's
that
not
would appeal
bad.
To each individual.
Yeah, yeah.
So school? I don't know.
Well, also, we have to think about who, as much as this kind of like sucks, we have to think about who are going to be the people who decide whether or not this passes.
Yeah. That would, I mean, that would be to persuade the counselors. We might not have to be there yet. Counselor Adams and I can't start to persuade counselors, because that's actually a form of deliberation. Depending, we can't go to all of them and say, "Would you do this?" before we go at public meetings to vote. But public, this happens with both the restaurants and with the counselors and the representatives. For the restaurants, as customers ask for and demand alternatives to styrofoam, they'll make those adjustments. That's their customer base. As counselors, hear from their constituents that they want a ban on styrofoam. And persuasive arguments, then that will also persuade them. You guys are now becoming a political entity, and that's what you do in politics. So you're in the persuasion and education point, which is really important. And I should mention that there's another constituent who's pushing very hard, and we haven't got there yet, for a plastic bag ban.
So, Paul Spector and I are considering that too.
As a separate ordinance for plastic bag?
Not sure. We still have to talk about that.
That would be tough.
I think we would prefer to keep it separate.
Nice recommendation.
Well, I think if you just thought politically, and why would you want to keep them separate?
Because it would be easier to tackle one and then the other.
Yeah. I actually agree with that. I agree with that.
Like butter
them
up with the
cider foam. Right. And also, if you have a good process template with this ordinance, you can follow up with that same process on that one, if that were to happen.
It would make it easier for the community to accept. If this was a successful campaign and you work on this, it's an ordinance, and the community gets comfortable with it, then, and the same with business owners, then it might not be as difficult to pass a plastic bag thing.
Also, working in a business, I work at State Street, we use a significant amount of plastic bags. I know the entire town uses a significant amount, whereas styrofoam is less.
Right.
It's a much
less prominent, and therefore by cutting off, like, we will be able to cut off styrofoam, I believe. I think it's a much harder fight to cut off plastic bags.
I agree with you.
You just described the selection of low-hanging fruit. You're picking low-hanging fruit, the easier ones to go for, which makes sense when, particularly if you're going to go deal with a controversial issue. So you just made another political decision.
Another thing that I was thinking about is that I work in a restaurant, and I used to work at India House, and that's kind of a restaurant that's been around for a long time. It's locally respected, you know, yada yada. They didn't use any styrofoam. I now work at a small Chinese restaurant, and they use like one or two styrofoam containers. But I know that the restaurant is like just kind of like keeping their head above the water. So also, there's this dynamic of who's actually making money. It's the people who are making the money that have the option to.
That's exactly right. On me at the India House has, you know, $21-$25 entrees.
Yeah.
So if you get that as to go, he can absorb the cost on that. If you're doing a $5 food item, then suddenly it becomes a more critical issue, because the amount of money that you're making for the same amount of energy and work is far less. So and that's the consideration that we have to take. You know, it's the, you're absolutely right. And what you're talking about, remember we talked about progressive and regressive taxation?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a form of regressive taxation. The ones who can afford it are going to be much more capable of absorbing this. The ones that are particularly challenged and having a tough time, it's going to be more difficult for them. They'd have to pay the same prices as these guys, it's just they have more money. So, something to consider, and I think when you're doing your survey. And as such, when you're doing your survey, don't prejudge them. I think if you're going in, you can prejudge them if they're making, you know, they're charging $45 an entree and then giving you something in styrofoam. You can also start with your school. Are they still doing styrofoam trays?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Oh, wow.
I mean, they don't do them every day anyway, so I don't know.
They only do them sometimes?
We also started a compost,
Yeah,
Ben, that's not doing very well, yeah. So I think that
also. So as
we're inching closer to the end, can we discuss?
No one has a question.
Yes, go ahead.
I actually went to lunch for the first time all year and they served styrofoam trays.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Let's discuss what we plan on doing for our next meeting.
Well, I think along those lines, is anyone interested in going and talking to restaurants?
No? First, we need to drop a survey and what we're going to ask.
Yeah, questionnaire.
If we got the survey done at the next meeting and then talk to all, like, assigned restaurants and just have people talk to them to the next one.
And did we want to talk to a woman in the service?
I think we should wait until we're
okay.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yes.
Would this commission be willing to do the day this Amherst? You might have discussed this already. Like 10 reasons to ban foam, styrofoam, or something like that. So we can be giving that out.
So begin thinking about specific outreach options.
Well, I think, and if I could also ask,
what will be the next steps for this committee? Will you be taking this matter up again at the next meeting?
Yeah.
These guys meet twice a month, so there's a fair amount of flexibility that you would find with us. So 2 weeks from now, the
first
and third. Let me say here. Poster, handbills, webpage, bullet points is what Councilor Adams talked about. Essentially, bullet points, you know, each thing condensed to one brief sentence so that, and then people want to drill down, they can read more information, but on a website, but those bullet points just to make the case and, you know, avoid things like, because styrofoam squeaks and it's annoying, that wouldn't be one of the reasons to ban it. That would be strong enough to make a case, although that would be fun to put in video. If you want to.
And what we could do with like a simple poster is hand it out to schools as well. So I decided.
Exactly, schools. And remember, you also, in restaurants, restaurant management systems and stuff like that.
Right, but as a youth commission, reaching
out. Yeah, as a youth commission, but yeah. Reaching out to youth, but right now you're also talking about reaching out to the city at large. And by the way, we're also talking Florence and Leeds, so just so everyone knows.
This is later in the process, but something that we should do is start creating like a kind of reward system, like have like styrofoam free restaurant. If that's something that goes on the door,
you can do that. It wouldn't be in the ordinance. In the case of promotion, it's the carrot versus stick program where you honor people who do make these choices, and then thereby the people who don't, it becomes evident, or this, you know, make a label that says this restaurant is styrofoam free, something like that.
Also, it would be nice if you wanted to do something like that. You know, the council meetings, when this reaches the council, gets voted on, are public, are on TV. If you're listing off those restaurants, you know, that's a way of rewarding them as well, by giving them public recognition.
We could also, if people were curious about any more about it, put the date of our next meeting up somewhere, or in the paper or something, so that if they wanted more information, they could come and listen in, which we always do have.
That's true, yeah. And it actually, these meetings are posted on the city website.
Well, we can make them more.
Yeah, you can do more outreach, because clearly we aren't getting the doors knocked down by people trying to watch our meetings. So,
correct. This is like excellent, but we need to add more muscle to it. So the committee who like created it has to work on it, but the
what do we need to add?
Well, I think we need to clear up our facts.
Right, but I think clear up your facts. Focus on the profit disparity between recyclables and styrofoam. Because you make a persuasive argument about health. You make a persuasive argument about landfill and environment. The argument's got to be more persuasive ultimately because of where the push is going to come to shove. I don't think we're going to have a lot of people running around saying styrofoam's good for you. That's not going to happen. So you're going to get a lot of pushback and saying it's relatively benign and we only use it when we have to. You know, if you go to Tom's, you go to the, actually it's not Tom's anymore. What's the hot dog place by the driving range?
Scotty's,
right. I think they use styrofoam where they used to. And you got to make a case to them why it'd be better not to do that.
It makes the french fries taste so good though.
Well, that's the thing is, I actually think it's a really sucky thing to eat out of is to drink coffee out of it.
Maybe it's the fries themselves that taste good.
No, all to-go containers ruin fries because they steam them when they're closed. That's the problem. So.
Right. Yeah, I know. So somebody has to do it. I can't do it.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Yeah. Oh. Any seconds?
Careful, we did that once in a council meeting and a bunch of other councils did and we got stuck.
Can't you just re-motion?
We eventually did. We were allowed to get our
second time. That's what we did, the second time. First time we had to stop.
Thank you guys, good job. Thank you very much.